Welcome back. I'm That Chemist, and today we're going to talk about five important papers that were published in the month of May 2022. Now, in this, there's going to be a couple papers that are just from the end of April, but I decided that I'd include those because they were particularly noteworthy. But first, I wanted to mention that one of the viewers of this channel, at RealChem on the Discord, made this beautiful logo of the channel in a transmission electron microscope, and I thought that I should just include it here because it's a pretty awesome thing that they did. If you think it's cool, you should go message them on the Discord and let them know that it's cool. Okay, so the first paper that I want to talk about from this month is this one making a new boronic ester group. And so typically, if you've done any chemistry with palladium or other cross-coupling chemistry, you'll be familiar with B-pin groups. And so this is like a boronic acid, but there's this pinnacle ester of the boronic acid. And so normally B-pin's common, but in this paper, what this group does is they make an B-epin group. And so it's like a B-pin, but instead of having methyl groups, it has ethyl groups. And so one of the ways that they prepare these is just by treating a boronic acid with this ethyl pinnacle derivative to get their pinnacle ester. And so some of the highlights of this include that the B-pin groups typically are fairly streaky by TLC, but their B-epin groups are actually less streaky and they're typically slightly less polar. So they run easier on TLC and they get less decomp. And so that's like a common issue with B-pin esters. And so in the next slide, I'll show you some examples of TLCs where you can see that this is massively improved. Additionally, for their subsequent conversions to di-aryl compounds using Suzuki reactions, they actually get higher conversions than you typically would with a boronic acid or a B-pin group. So this is actually really relevant for medicinal chemistry. Additionally, they have better stability than the boronic acids or the B-pin groups towards alkaline conditions. And so here you can see that when we do a TLC of a compound with a B-pin group versus a B-epin group, you can see that you're getting some streaking, and also it's a lot more polar. Additionally, they talk a little bit more about what percentage of their boronic acid was recovered when they subjected to a silica gel plug. And so it'd be worth reading this paper and seeing all the cool stuff that they do in there, but I didn't want to take away from the entire paper by just showing everything. So the one thing I want to mention about this is someone in the Discord originally brought this paper to my attention, and they actually ended up trying this methodology, and it worked on a much larger molecule than anything that was reported in this paper, and it like doubled their yield, and it was a lot cleaner of a reaction than their corresponding reaction with a B-pin group. So if you're in medicinal chemistry or industry and you're working on some target-oriented synthesis, it's definitely worth checking this out, because this could solve a problem that you're having. So some of the scope that this includes, just demonstrated here, shows the Suzuki reaction between the boronic acid B-pin or B-epin groups, and you can see in their conditions they get much higher conversions when they use the B-epin group. Now this might be subjective depending on conditions, but if you don't think that it's going to be like that cool, you should just go test it out with your chemistry and see if it improves. Now the one thing I want to mention is that that pinnacle isn't commercially available, and you have to make it using a pinnacle coupling reaction with 3-pentanone, but it's 3-pentanone's commercially available and it's dirt cheap, and there's lit preps that you can follow. So it's possible to make this yourself, even though it's not commercially available yet. Okay, so the next paper I want to talk about is the use of mercaptoethanol as a deprotecting agent for certain carbamates. So I actually know the lead author on this paper, Thomas Scatalin, and I had seen this paper in Orglet recently, and so I talked to him about it a bit. And so what they do in this paper is they demonstrate the orthogonal deprotection of certain carbamates using mercaptoethanol. And so this is a metal-free method. It tolerates heterocycles as well as a wide range of functional groups. And so the mechanism that they envisioned is that instead of doing like palladium on carbon to get rid of a benzyl carbamate, they envisioned an SN2 type reaction displacing the carbamate group from the benzyl group. And they ended up engineering conditions that worked really well for this. It's also a mild scalable methodology, and the byproduct is easy to remove. They don't discuss this in their paper, but the resulting products that they get after this mercaptoethanol attacks a benzylic group is a nice polar compound that can be removed when they are washing out their dimethyl acetamide. And so essentially what happens here is you can see in this case they use mercaptomethanol to attack this position. You can see CO2 is liberated, and then they get their free amine as well as this product. Now they've also done some mechanistic stuff to show how this works, and I'd encourage you to check out the paper to see more details on that. Now the main reason that they had developed this was originally they were working on a project trying to make this target compound 1A shown here. And the issue that they had with palladium on carbon to deprotect this was they were getting partial reduction of their nitrile, as well as some proto-dehalogenation of their aryl bromide, which is a problem that you really want to avoid when you're trying to make stuff on a kilo scale. And they had a contract, or they needed to make this on a large scale. So it was important to minimize any impurities that they could. So if you're doing any deprotection chemistry, such as like in total synthesis, etc., it would be worth checking this paper out. You can see that this also tolerates N-Boc groups, as it's too bulky for this nucleophile to attack at the tertiary position. So the third paper I want to talk about is the conversion of aryl boronic acids to anilines. And so the cool thing about this is they use 2-nitropropane as their nitrogen source. They also utilize an organocatalyst to mediate this transformation, and this is a new way that you can access anilines. So as I said, this is just kind of what I just outlined. They have a really good scope, good yields, and it tolerates heterocycles with electron withdrawing groups and electron donating groups. They've also demonstrated this methodology on several complex examples. And so the mechanism of this reaction is essentially as follows. They use hexamethyl disilane to react with 2-nitropropane. This then gives you this nitrone-like species, which can then be hydrolyzed by acetone to afford this nitrogen bis-OTMS species, which can then lose HMDS again, giving this HNO species. This HNO species can react with their phosphine catalyst, giving us this 3-membered ring, which can then be attacked by a boronic acid, giving an 8-complex, which can then undergo a 1-2 shift of the aryl group, affording this NBOH2 protected aniline product. And then in workup, this just gets converted to the aniline. And because this is a phosphine oxide, this can then get reduced by hydrosilane in situ, regenerating the catalyst. And so they demonstrate this on several complex examples, such as these drug derivatives here, as well as this derivative of an amino acid. Okay, so this is a cool method, definitely worth checking out if you need to prepare anilines. And this is kind of a nice approach that complements existing methodology. So the fourth paper I want to talk about is this chiral aryylation of amines. In the examples that I'm going to show you, they're mostly N-benzoyl pyrrolidines, but they also demonstrate this on other amines in their paper. Some of the highlights include really good EEs, 81 to 97% EEs, which is just enantiomeric excess if you're not familiar with that. They also get decent yields. It tolerates heterocycles, many functional groups, as well as the utilization of aryl and heteroaryl chlorides, which is not too commonly seen in this type of chemistry. It's kind of similar to Macmillan chemistry, except in this case, they're using chloride as a chlorine radical source instead of using a tertiary amine such as quinuclidine or dabco, as you would see in the Macmillan group's work. They've also demonstrated this on several complex examples. And so in this paper, the mechanism that they draw out isn't super clear, but basically the excited iridium photocatalyst is able to oxidize a chloride anion to a chlorine radical. This chlorine radical is then able to abstract a proton from this N-benzoyl amine. This then generates a radical that can couple to nickel 2. Once nickel 2 reacts, you get a nickel 3 species, which can then be reduced by the iridium 2 photocatalyst to give the iridium 3 ground state again, as well as the reduced nickel 1 species. So this nickel 1 species is able to undergo an oxidative addition with your aryl or your heteroaryl chloride, and then through subsequent reductive elimination, you get your product in good enantioselectivity. And so the enantioselectivity of this reaction is determined through the ligand that they use. And so here you can see several examples that they did on complex molecules, and you can see this is quite an impressive transformation given the functional group compatibility of this. So cool paper, you should definitely check it out. Now the fifth and final paper that I want to talk about today is the conversion of aryl bromides and iodides to phenols. And so some of the highlights of this paper include the nickel catalyzed conversion of aryl bromides and iodides to phenols using nitrous oxide. This also tolerates heterocycles, a wide range of functional groups in general, and it was demonstrated on several complex examples. And so here the mechanism of the reaction is first you have this nickel species which is able to get reduced. And so once this occurs, you can have an oxidative addition. Nitrous oxide is then able to act as an oxygen donor, and through the elimination of nitrogen, you get this metal complexation to the phenol product. And then through subsequent reduction, you turn over your catalyst back to the ground state. Okay, and so they demonstrate this on several complex examples, and here you can see that they're able to synthesize phenols, where they previously just had an aryl bromide or iodide, with several common motifs found in pharmaceutical compounds. So this is another cool paper that you should definitely check out. There's also some other good papers that if you have some spare time to read, I'd encourage you to check these ones out. They didn't quite make the cutoff, but if you're going to read any of these, you should definitely read this paper where they demonstrate the ring contraction of quinoline N-oxides to prepare heterocycles such as indoles. Really cool paper, definitely worth checking out. But as I already had five, I don't have enough time to talk about all these because your time is precious. So hopefully you've enjoyed this. I'd appreciate it if you have any comments, you leave them down below. It would really help out the channel if you left a like and subscribed. And I hope you have a great day.